Well, good afternoon, everyone, and thank you so much for coming. My name is Jen Mason Mack Ward. I'm the director of the Center for Civil and Human Rights, and I'd like to welcome you to this lecture by Dr. Meghan Clark. It's entitled A Life of Dignity for All, Human Rights, Catholic Social Teaching, and Sustainable Development. I'd like to thank the Center for Social Concerns for sharing this beautiful space with us and co-sponsoring this talk. And as many of you know, this event is part of today's launch of the Center for Civil and Human Rights' new database called Convocate. It's the fruit of years of partnership between the Center and the Hesburgh Libraries. It's an innovative research tool that positions Notre Dame at the forefront of inquiry into connections between international human rights law and Catholic social teaching. And so we couldn't think of anybody better to bring to Notre Dame to help flesh out those connections than Dr. Clark. Immediately after her talk, I wanted to invite each of you to join us at the Center for Digital Scholarship, which is on the first floor of the Hesburgh Library, where you'll be able to explore, convocate this database yourself. We will have stations set up and people to help you explore and use the database. There will also be delicious and ample refreshments, which will be welcome on a Friday afternoon. But now I'm pleased to introduce to you Professor Dr. Meghan Clark, who's with us today from St. John's University. She's an assistant professor of theology and religious studies and moral theology, but she just got tenure, so perhaps I should introduce her as an associate professor. She received her BA from Fordham University and her doctorate in theological ethics from Boston College and joined St. John's in 2011. Her many appointments include service as a fellow of the Institute of Policy Research and Catholic Studies at the Catholic University of America, a consultant to the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops Committee on Domestic Justice, and her current role as a faculty expert for the Holy See's mission to the United Nations. Professor Clark's research interests are in Catholic social thought, especially human rights and solidarity. As a social ethicist, she focuses on questions of global health, economic development, participation, and justice in Catholic moral theology and public or political theology. She's the author of a fabulous book called The Vision of Catholic Social Thought, The Virtue of Solidarity, and the Praxis of Human Rights. And she's a columnist for U.S. Catholic Magazine, and she blogs at Catholic Moral Theology and Millennial Journal. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Meghan Clark.
Okay. Did I turn it on?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. And thank you everyone for coming on a Friday afternoon of what looks like a fun spring weekend here at Notre Dame. The title for my talk comes from a line from then Secretary General Ban Ki-moon. In his 2013 report to the General Assembly, setting up the debate and discussion for setting the new sustainable development agenda, he articulated a clear goal for the United Nations, a life of dignity for all. He said, ultimately, the aspiration of the development agenda beyond 2015 is to create a just and prosperous world where all people realize their rights and live with dignity and hope. Catholic social teaching has much to contribute to this conversation and envisioning of what it means to have a life of dignity for all. And in particular, it can provide a framework for working together for human rights and development. And so we begin with a common goal, what is a life of dignity for all? Framing the human rights agenda through the lens of dignity is emotionally persuasive. As development economist and philosopher Amartya Sen notes, there is something deeply attractive to the idea that every person anywhere in the world, irrespective of citizenship or territorial legislation, has some basic rights which others should respect. The Universal Declaration begins with the affirmation of, quote, the inherent dignity and of the equal and inalienable right foundation, the inherent dignity and of the equal and inalienable rights of all members of the human family, end quote, in Article 1. While the human dignity is accepted as the foundation for human rights, any theoretical explanation is generally avoided in human rights discourse. Human rights scholars cannot agree on the role of human dignity in human rights laws and human rights agendas. When the 1948 Declaration was agreed upon, Jacques Maritain joked that everybody could agree on the rights as long as nobody asked why. As philosopher Charles Beats recently noted, quote, many friends of human rights believe we cannot understand their special importance without a grasp of the value of human dignity. Yet on the other hand, it is easy to remain suspicious that the idea of human dignity can do useful work in our thinking about nature and basis of human rights. Beats and others prefer to focus on the practice. What are we going to do? However, human dignity and the language of human dignity remains central to the practice of human rights, articulations of it, and pretty much every document that comes out, it talks about human rights at the United Nations. And so even though defining it is a problem, it's still there as the central rhetorical tool that they use in talking about the development agenda. So what does the United Nations mean when it talks about human dignity, and what might that have in common with Catholic social teaching? What is a life of dignity? In this context, a life of dignity is understood in terms of the minimum conditions of human flourishing. That gets set by the basic Universal Declaration of Human Rights and the subsequent covenants at the UN. Clarifying human dignity within the UN practice itself is complicated because it gets used in many different ways. Philosopher Pablo Guillebert notes that some utterances seem to refer to human dignity as an inherent property of human beings, a status they constantly have rather than one they can achieve. At the same time, some other statements appear to refer to dignity as a more contingent state that human beings may come to enjoy, and this includes certain treatment by others, including the fact that dignity can and often is attacked or violated. Surveying the UN documents and practices, he argues that there are, in fact, two categories of dignity found within the UN canon. Status dignity, right, that which you always have, and conditioned dignity. Status dignity is intimately tied to freedom and self-determination. At the same time, conditioned dignity seeks to elaborate the social conditions required in order for human persons to develop and substantively exercise these rights and capabilities. This assumption about conditioned dignity undergirds the right to development and what we see now in the UN development agenda. As philosopher and Catholic martyr Ignacio Ellacuría emphasizes, let us not forget that human rights are proclaimed as rights aimed at all of humanity in order to guarantee the satisfaction of basic needs and dignity. Right? It's something we talk about it as something people have, but also as something that requires certain conditions. Human dignity is the starting point for both human rights and solidarity in Catholic social teaching, in both its theology and as it seeks to engage all people of goodwill. Exposing the lack of respect for human dignity present in the world today, Pope Francis laments in Evangelii Gaudium that human beings are themselves considered consumer goods to be used and then discarded. It is no longer simply about exploitation and oppression, but something new, exclusion. Exclusion ultimately has to do with what it means to be part of the society in which we live. Those excluded are no longer society's underside or its fringes or its disenfranchised. They are no longer even a part of it. Here one sees the same complexity of human dignity in Catholic social thought as in the United Nations. It is at once inherent and also lived or denied in a complex and contingent social reality. The reason for seeking a life of dignity for all, says Francis, is that others are not yet able to live a way worthy of their human dignity. Catholic theology spends a lot of time grappling with the already but not yet aspect of human dignity, justice, and peace. Two aspects of Catholic social thought here help clarify dignity and set the boundaries for establishing just and strong bonds of global solidarity, and can help us maybe understand a bit more what maybe the UN is getting at with having these two different ways of talking about it. First, dignity incorporates the developmental aspect of human life, the centrality of becoming. Working for peace and justice is predicated on the idea that we can become more fully human, more just, more free, and create a more peaceful community. Second, dignity is not merely individual, but communal. Each of us has equal human dignity, and at the same time, communities have dignity as well. We have dignity. Thus, an overarching and inclusive vision emerges that truly seeks a life of dignity for all. This is one place where Catholic social thought converges with broader secular philosophical traditions looking at the social and relational aspects of the human person. It is also a point where deeper theological commitment is at play as well. Human dignity as tied to the Imago Dei, or image of God, which is also a question in Christianity of how we image God in the world. Imago Trinitatis. What does it mean to be created in the image and likeness of the triune God? Three persons in one God. Looking more at the Trinity is a question that is beyond the scope of my presentation today, but a connection that I detail in the book that Jennifer talked about and how it is that we can understand both more about human rights and solidarity by thinking about how we are imaging God in the world. Achieving a life of dignity for all requires embracing that we are one human family. In his 1987 World Day of Peace message, Development and Solidarity, and I feel bad for the people who are sitting right behind this screen, Pope John Paul II insisted, quote, "We are one human family. Simply by being born into this world, we are of one inheritance and one stock with every other human being. This oneness expresses itself in the richness and diversity of the human family," end quote. The universality of human rights depends upon the dignity of the human person inviolably present in all persons, but its universality is not uniformity. In this focus on equality and reciprocity, Pope Francis argues that there are no disposable lives. All men and women enjoy as equal and inviolable dignity, and for this reason, no one can remain indifferent to the lot of our brothers and sisters. Interdependence and community, then, are integral to our understanding of the persons who are subjects of human rights and have human dignity. Inclusion, which always pushes us to see individuals and communities otherwise overlooked, is crucial for a life of dignity for all. This emphasis on brothers and sisters in the one human family, regardless of creed, is a point of convergence with the spirit of solidarity called for by the United Nations Secretary General as the heart of the new development agenda. Over the next 15 years, the systematic international focus on matters of human rights and development, with the exception of emerging conflicts and natural disasters and emergencies, is the 2030 Sustainable Development Agenda. In seeking to be people-centered and planet-sensitive, the United Nations has come up with 17 goals, and at this point, I don't even know how many indicators contained within each of these goals. My focus today is not to examine in detail the SDG or their indicators, but take a step back and look at the whole picture and focus on where I think Catholic social teaching can help give us an ethical framework for implementing human rights that all of us here care so deeply about, and also to see the ways in which the convergences seem to be growing rather than shrinking if we look at where we are now from where we are 25, 30 years ago, right? In particular, And this is something that would be very different from if you looked at earlier conceptions of human rights and development goals, right? People working with the UN on kind of messaging and thinking about how we move forward have created a pyramid for the SDGs, looking at the goals that they identify as having to do with people, having to do with the planet, ecological, and then putting the most basic inclusive attention to peace and to partnerships as spiritual goals, right? As somehow getting beyond simply individual and bringing us together, right? And so my proposal is that actually where we have, the places we have for dialogue are growing rather than shrinking between the secular human rights agenda and Catholic social teaching. And that actually, if we look at this, Catholic social teaching gives us an awful lot to help us think about how is it that we work together in a way that is just and respects everybody's dignity and not just reproducing problematic power structures that we've had before. So a little bit of background for the question of development and human rights in Catholic social teaching. The relationship between Catholic social teaching and human rights has at times been contentious. However, in 1963, Pope John XXIII officially incorporated, adapted, and adopted the rhetoric, the language of human rights in an encyclical called Pacem in Terris, or Peace on Earth. John sought to integrate and expand the canon of human rights by offering a fairly systematic listing of human rights and corresponding duties. Similarly, Catholic social teaching's emphasis on the common good recognizes both the importance of community functionally and the value of community itself, the sense that we really are more than just the sum of our parts. Recognizing and living out one's own individual human rights is not sufficient. All human rights include the primary duties of reciprocity and mutual collaboration. Founded upon the equality of all, human rights demand that when we recognize our own, we have a duty to recognize the rights of others. In Pacem in Terris, it says, once this is admitted, it also follows that in human society, to one man's right, there corresponds a duty in all other persons, the duty, namely, of acknowledging and respecting the right in question, end quote. This sense that we have a profound obligation to promote the human rights and flourishing of others as part of the common good is also where, in Catholic social teaching, we get the seeds of a right to development. My own substantive exercise of my human rights is contingent on my striving for the substantive exercise of these rights for each and every individual and community. Here we see this deep already but not yet, as well as personal and communal aspects to human dignity. Based upon this, the next step after Peace on Earth was the recognition of a right to development, the central theme for his successor, Paul VI. The clearest defense of a right to development as a central human right came in 1971's Synod of Bishops statement, Justice in the World. The Synod states, in the face of international systems of domination, the bringing about of justice depends more and more on the determined will for development. This is expressed in an awareness of the right to development. The right to development must be seen as a dynamic interpenetration of all those fundamental human rights upon which the aspirations of individuals and nations are based. It is a clear example of a distinctive aspect of Catholic social thought on human rights. And interestingly enough, it comes almost about 20 years before the United Nations releases its own declaration on the right to development as a human right. It illustrates this both individual persons and communities can be the subject of rights, and dignity can be understood both personally and communally. development touches all faces of human life, not only the economic or the political. Paul the Sixth explains, it is not just certain individuals, but all persons who are called to this fullness of development. We have inherited from past generations, we have benefited from the work of our contemporaries. For this reason, we have obligations towards all. The reality of human solidarity, which as a benefit for us, also imposes a duty. Adding to this, Paul speaks of a spirit of solidarity in which it is recognized that there can be no progress towards the complete development of the human person without the simultaneous development of all humanity in a spirit of solidarity. Again, interdependence is not simply a functional question, but also a moral one. What does it mean for us to be human together? One of our roundtables this morning focused on integral human development and solidarity. And as we think about the question of human rights and sustainable development and what it might mean to pursue a life of dignity for all, I want to set out as a starting point the ethical practice of local listening and share with you two stories from a brief visit that I had, along with Hal in the room here, to northern Ghana, both of which I think demonstrate simultaneously the personal and the communal aspects of development. In July 2015, I spent 2 weeks in Ghana with Catholic Relief Services, mostly spent visiting communities and development projects. While we were there, there was virtually no rain. Up in Tamale, Archbishop Philip kept longingly looking at the clouds in the sky in hopes that real rain would come, not an isolated storm, but the real rains that they had been waiting for. In mid-July, the fields of northern Ghana should already be teeming with corn, their second crop. That year, the first millet crop was not yet fully grown. Traditionally, the rainy season is 4 to 5 months, during which they grow four crops. Due to climate change, that is shrinking to only 2 to 3 months. The shrinking rainy season is drastically impacting the people's ability to grow enough food, maintain an agriculture sector, and address critical health needs. Surrounded by challenges they cannot change, the women of northern Ghana are creatively working together for the flourishing of their communities. Enhancing participation of women is a hallmark of sustainable development. A staple at your local fair trade store are baskets from Bogatanga, Ghana. Full of intricate patterns and vibrant colors, these baskets are not rural handicrafts, but beautiful functional works of art. While visiting a weaving cooperative in Bolga, I was honored to listen to the women's stories and mesmerized by their attention to detail as they weaved. Speaking through interpreters, two generations of women shared stories of how working together enables them to fill bigger basket orders, and more important, they earn more money to build their farms, pay school fees, and buy health insurance. I now have the courage and confidence to speak out, Ellen proudly shared with our group. Her voice was magnified by her colleagues and the women we met in other cooperatives. The rainy season, our global financial structures are outside their control. But if you listen, they are steering the sustainable development of their communities. About a 90-minute drive away, we visited a CRS program in the East Mamprusi district of northern Ghana called EPICS, Encouraging Positive Practices in Child Survival, a complex long-term health project involving CRS, USAID, the Ghana Health Service, and the University of Development Studies. There is much one could say about this community-based project, in which all sectors of the population were consulted in some way as they set up the program, including the local chiefs and imams, and its drastic success in improving child health and lowering infant mortality. One of the most exciting moments for our group was when we sat with a group of mothers And my colleague, via a translator, asked the women if they found the program and its peer-led support groups helpful. Did they notice a difference? And one mother almost jumped up, responding yes, holding up, how smiling, holding up this healthy, about 6 to 8 month old baby. Look, she said. But in thinking about human rights and sustainable development, and what it means to seek a life of dignity for all, I always find myself thinking back to Shifura Mamanadu, pictured in the center here. A traditional birth attendant by training, her participation in EPICS trained her as a link provider, taking her existing role in the community and involved to being more similar to what we would call a doula, a birth companion. The title they give is link provider. In her community, by becoming this link provider, she is the one who accompanies and facilitates pregnant women's transfer to the community clinic for delivery, only delivering herself when she's called too late for transport. And I share with you today what she shared with me because I think it demonstrates clearly why our shared goal in human rights and sustainable development is a life of dignity for all, and the ways in which, even as this is communal, it's a deeply personal thing. Empirically, we can focus on basic needs and development in almost a clinical or scientific way, in which dignity becomes a thing to be measured. And we all have experienced the kind of the push for data and the looking for assessment tools and the ways in which things can get reduced to numbers. And I'm not knocking data, but there's something else going on when we talk about a life of dignity for all. Yet the insight of Catholic social teaching, and which in some ways is brought out by the secular capabilities approach, is that there's always something deeply personal, something unquantifiable going on when we talk about empowerment and extending human rights and human dignity. While Ms. Mamanadu detailed the benefits of her new training in being able to better care for pregnant women and babies, the point she most emphasized was the empowerment that came as the result that went far beyond her professional role, far beyond the fact that she was given knowledge to better identify who was high risk, when there was an emergency, low-tech ways to test to see if things are getting bad and someone needs to go to a clinic earlier, was the voice that she found. Speaking through a translator, she said, "Previously, I could not speak in the midst of men. But now, I can speak even in front and to the chiefs." Further, she indicated that this was true among other mothers as well. They had not before, but now had, a stronger voice within their families and within the broader communities. This sense that we see, even as we're looking at something that is deeply personal, what is the empowerment of one woman and the way she sees it and the way it's tied to the empowerment of other women, right? Things are at once deeply personal, but also communal. And this steers the development of the community in a way that is more focused on inclusion and listening to more voices. So beginning with, and here you can see the mother's group and the basket weavers in Bolga. And while it is not a field of growing corn, because I could not find that picture, you can tell from the picture just how dry everything was, how dusty everything was for lack of rain. If we begin with local listening, and we start with this personal and communal aspect, one of the things I work on is that I think that there is kind of a framework in Catholic social teaching that we can use to help us work together in such a way as we don't simply reproduce existing power structures. We're not coming in and telling a community what to do. But we actually can walk together towards a civilization or a community of solidarity. This is what I've come up with. Recognizing that if we actually had this, if we actually were moving towards a life of dignity for all, what that would look like would be a community of solidarity. Seeking this solidarity, though, does not come out of thin air and must be built upon a firm foundation of distinct yet related principles, each of which safeguards particular aspects of structural justice. As illustrated in the pyramid, building partnerships working together for solidarity, I think, rests upon three basic principles. Sustainability, a functional principle for evaluating justice and resources across time. Subsidiarity, an instrumental principle which helps us navigate decision-making. The principle of subsidiarity is perhaps one of the most misused in Catholic social teaching. You hear it referred to a lot in public debates and almost never accurately. What it doesn't mean is it does not mean smaller is better. It doesn't mean local government's better or smaller government is better. What it means is that decisions should happen in the most local way possible, but at the greatest level necessary. And so when things can be done by a local community, they are. And decisions like questions related to climate, right, things that can't be dealt with simply by local communities across, they have to be developed by bigger communities. Sometimes that's the state, sometimes that's the federal government, sometimes that's the international community. And that there's a continuum up and down, right? It's a tool. It's not a value or a goal. It's a tool to help us figure out where's the best place to make a decision. And the reason I say it's instrumental and necessary for working for sustainable development and solidarity is because built within it is that all of us should be doing everything we can to support all of the many facets and layers of human community. Right? So what can Ghana, as a country, do to support the development of local communities? Not taking it over, right, but actually reallocating resources where they're most necessary in order for communities to do what they need to do. Similarly, right, when a family or a community or even a nation state is unwilling or unable to do what it is supposed to do to protect the human rights of people, then the international community or the nation has the right and the responsibility to intervene. Perhaps the easiest case to think about is civil rights legislation. Right? A number of states had shown they were unwilling or unable to desegregate, right, and pass civil rights, and so we had federal legislation. This sense of moving up and down, right? Because for Catholic social teaching, everything from the person and the family up through the global community is important and has its place. And all of those intermediary groups in between, including parishes, churches, universities, right? All of us, all of our communities have a place and function. Right? And the thing that holds this all together and kind of acts as a check is participation. Participation as a methodological principle to push for greater inclusion and pull together all of these principles, kind of like mortar if you're building a building. Because moving towards greater participation has to be there in all of them. Part of why I began with the question of local listening, right? How do we start from a place where what we're doing first is listening and finding ways to bring in the active participation and empowerment of those who otherwise are not counted in the voices that get to make decisions? Now, through balancing all of these, I think that what we find in Catholic social thought is a framework that can help us move together towards a life of dignity for all. Now, each of these could be the focus of today's talk, and each of them are integral, but given that we're on the eve of Earth Day, I decided to focus only on sustainability. About three times as I was typing up my notes, I had to go back and say, no. So I kept interchanging subsidiarity and sustainability. According to the United Nations, sustainability calls for a decent standard of living for everyone without compromising the needs of future generations. The principle of sustainability has two elements: evaluating the use of resources, right, where we locate environmental justice, and assessing the impact of something over time, beyond our current context. What in Catholic social teaching we would point to and as the starting point for intergenerational justice. This helps clarify sustainability, the focus on intergenerational justice and environmental justice as part of it, the integrity of creation as part of it, within a larger moral framework, is one of the things that Catholic social thought offers in the conversation about sustainable development. First, it is the criteria by which, sustainability is the criteria by which we evaluate the use and distribution of resources, natural and other. From oil to water, there are increasing calls for attention to both the limits as well as distribution of natural resources. As the example of farming in northern Ghana illustrates, nowhere is this more acute than in regards to the negative impacts of climate change, which are rarely felt in proportion to one's carbon footprint. The poor and most vulnerable populations bear the greatest burden of ecological change and have had the least access to the natural resources necessary for a life of dignity and the least impact on the current situation. Second, sustainability is the means by which we evaluate beyond the current context across time. Questions of viability beyond where we are now are often the focus when structuring partnerships for human rights, as well as the current international focus on sustainable development. We hear this a lot when you look at things like global health programs, right? But very often, sustainability questions become a question of sustaining the program. And that's not that that's not important. But are we sustaining a program, or are we sustaining outcomes? Sustainability of what is a question that is often incredibly vague when you look at current general discussions and debates about sustainable development and sustainability itself within the wider human rights and development conversation. It's a place where people like Paul Farmer have been incredibly critical of the global health conversations. Because what is it that we're sustaining? Right? Are we sustaining the program that we've put in, or are we looking at building capabilities and sustaining outcomes in a community? Right? It's one, this kind of ambiguity concerning sustainability is one of the things that he and others have pointed to as a critique as to why the international community was not able to respond as quickly as it should have to the Ebola crisis. Because things became too entrenched in this is the one thing that gets done here, and less kind of the fluidity of public health. Public health itself is always a moving target, right? And so it pushes us to think a little bit differently about sustainability. For Catholic social thought, this goes even further theologically, because the environment is seen, as Pope Benedict says in Caritas in Veritate, as God's gift to everyone. And in our use of it, we have a responsibility towards the poor, towards future generations, and towards humanity as a whole. Reflecting broadly on human rights and the modern social imaginary, philosopher Charles Taylor sees this obligation as rooted in the perpetuation of civilization. Future generations, he says, will need this civilization to reach these aspirations. And if we affirm their worth, we have an obligation to make them available to others. This obligation is only increased if we ourselves have benefited from this civilization and have been enabled to become free agents ourselves. If I have benefited from having substantive exercise of human rights, I have an obligation to promote and protect that development for others. This fact is deeply understood by the women I met in northern Ghana. But the question they, I think, have grappled with, that I don't know that we here in the United States have, is that what is my obligation? Right? I have these rights protected. I've benefited from them. Now, how do I think about what my obligation is to others? I think that has to begin with local listening and being creative but also incredibly humble about what our obligations to future generations might mean. Thus, integral human development and sustainability in Catholic social thought is rooted in this deep connection between the past, the present, and future generations, the universality of the goods of creation, the idea that the world was created for all, and creating the obligation that we have now in creating a civilization of human rights. The principle of sustainability, then, brings together intergenerational justice and solidarity on one hand, and ecological justice and solidarity on the other, such that neither can be sacrificed. Hoarding of natural resources, abuse of those resources, or polluting them, such as water, is simultaneously here an injustice against the environment, against the poor, and against future generations for Catholic social thought. And then again, because we are on the eve of Earth Day, anybody who knows me knows I'm a bit obsessed with elephants. According to Catholic social thought, the natural environment has an integrity that is not purely functional. Protecting and preserving the flourishing of natural habitats and species is a good on its own to be sought. In Laudato Si, Pope Francis begins saying that Sister Earth now cries out to us because of the harm we have inflicted on her. The violence present in our hearts, wounded by sin, is also reflected in the symptoms of sickness evident in the soil, in the water, in the air, and in all forms of life. One place this is clearest is in threats to species and the loss of biodiversity. Just as he calls for the need to draw near to persons who are most vulnerable in society, those whose human rights are being violated or likely to be violated, even if it brings no tangible benefit to ourselves in Evangelii Gaudium, in Laudato Si, the responsibility for ecological justice and ecological solidarity is not limited to natural environments which are deemed useful to humans. Even while its approach to ecology still remains fairly anthropocentric, Laudato Si emphasizes that nature cannot be regarded as something that is separate from ourselves, or as a mere setting in which we live. We are part of nature. In fall 2015, I spent a semester teaching religion and peace building at the Hekima Institute for Peace Studies and International Relations in Nairobi, Kenya. One of the places I visited quite a lot was the Sheldrake Elephant Orphanage. As I said, I adore elephants. They fascinate me. And so it was one of the first places I visited in Nairobi, and one of the places I visited every chance I got. Located on the edge of Nairobi National Park, the David Sheldrake Wildlife Trust is famous for its rearing of baby elephants that have been orphaned and reintroducing them into the wild, a process that can take 10 to 15 years. In parts of Tsavo National Park, there are now entire herds of formerly orphaned elephants, reintroducing them to a remote part of the park that, as a result of poachers and migration, had no longer had elephants, right? And so they're not competing then with existing wild herds, but repopulating a part of the park. My final thoughts today are about my experiences at Sheldrake and what it taught me about ecological solidarity. And so I want to introduce you to Kamak, my foster elephant. Orphaned shortly after birth, villagers found Kamak alone, weak, and unstable, wandering in a conservancy. Luckily, she was rescued by the Sheldrake and taken to the nursery in Nairobi. Unlike most of her friends, she was orphaned by natural causes. Most, however, are orphaned due to human-elephant conflict. Since they are large and communal, elephants require significant land. But they are losing their natural habitat due to human expansion. At the same time, elephants can cause great damage when they wander into rural villages looking for water. As water and land become increasingly scarce, the competition between elephants and humans increases, not to mention the threat that they find from poachers, right? People who simply want their ivory to fund, as we now know, terrorism. Al-Shabaab gets 40% of its revenue from illicit ivory sales, as well as all kinds of, I can't think of a polite way to put it, but ideas that people have about various miracle things that will happen if you ingest ivory or use it for various things. Today, Kamak is a thriving youth who's outgrown the nursery and was just transferred to the Ithumba Reintegration Unit in Tsavo. In this photo here, she is playing with a newborn, wild-born baby elephant whose ex-orphan herd comes to visit the reintegration unit. Elephants and humans share a deep emotional and social nature. The bonds among the elephants and their keepers is strong, continuing long after they are fully integrated into the wild. Often now, wild elephants bring back their new calves to introduce them to the humans at the integration unit. And this is the thing that I found really fascinating. When an elephant is sick, particularly when one of the baby elephants that are wild-born baby elephants are sick, the herd brings them to the reintegration unit so that they can be checked out. They recognize something is wrong, and they bring the baby. I was told the story of one where the mother elephant wasn't producing enough milk, and they were actually able to give her a shot of something so that she would then produce enough milk. But this relationship that goes on long after, they are fully wild and off on their own. As we approach Earth Day and continue our reflections on human rights and a life of dignity for all, encountering and thinking more about elephants provided me with a good reminder that sustainable development needs to reflect on the dignity of nature as well, and that somehow we need to think about even elephants as having a role when we say a life of dignity for all. Thank you. I don't know what we have time for. I know we started a little bit late, but I don't know where. If there's time for questions, I'm happy to. Questions, thoughts? I know I'm not glued to the text behind there.
Well, Professor, thanks for your presentation. I especially appreciated you pointing out how with the development of Catholic social teaching, how that's providing opportunities to dialogue with the secular liberal human rights tradition, too. I think this is seen most clearly with what Dr. C. Pope Francis' encyclical on the environment. My question is, with regard to the presentation on ecological solidarity, how does this relate to an understanding of human ecology? I was reminded of something Pope Francis spoke at a colloquium on the complementarity of man and woman, but also see this as applicable to the complementarity of mankind to the environment, in the sense of how does a greater awareness of the human environment or the natural environment relate to our awareness of the fragility of the social environment, and how does that relate together? Because I think the idea of human ecology can also relate to the idea of ecological solidarity, and how could you see that the interplay of that relating to fleshing out how CST can contribute to further human rights dialogue.
I think it's about humility. I mean, I think that's the key between them. Because I think, and this is for me, I think one of the more powerful points in Laudato Si, is the emphasis that, right, a lot of people kind of pull out, but he doesn't say Mother Earth, he says Sister Earth. That the sense that that we are created, right? And I do think Pope Francis in particular, if you look at what he's done and what he says and where he goes and his theology, that he really does have this sense that part of the problem is that we've forgotten we're created. And so part of, I think, that link is that, again, despite the fact that, I mean, my focus is on human rights and solidarity, so I think human dignity matters a great deal, right? I spent a lot of time looking at and talking about what it means to be created in the image and likeness of God. And God helped me, for some reason, when I was working on my dissertation and my book, thought it was a good idea to try and say something about what it means to be in the image of the Trinity. If you want to induce migraines, that's a really good path to follow. But here's the thing, even with all of that, we are more like the elephant than we are like God, right? We are created, right? And so that gap between creator and creation, that what we forget is that we are created just like the rest of creation, just like the natural world, just like those trees and the elephants and all of this biodiversity, right? And so while it's not the same, the gap between us and God is much greater than the gap between us and the elephants. And there's all kinds of things in science kind of that remind us of that. Kind of if you look at how much kind of our genetic material is similar to other forms of life, never mind how genetically similar all human beings are, right? We tend to emphasize differences in ways that divide when actually we're much more similar genetically than we often would like to admit. But I think that's part of it, is this humility gets us, because part of what stops us from seeing what is happening to my neighbor, right, the plight of Syrian refugees, as something that I have any responsibility for, right, is a lack of humility, right? A lack of seeing my own finitude, my own dependency on others, on God, on creation. And that's similarly, while it's not the same, creation also bears the imprint of the Creator. And so tells us something about God, and tells us something about glorifying God. And so this idea that there's dignity in creation that isn't at all tied to us, but is tied to the fact that creation is in a relationship with God too. Right? And so that we don't have the right to kind of eliminate things that God created, right? In terms of the loss of biodiversity and kind of the pollution of waterways and the kind of the only taking care of aspects of the environment that are useful or benefit us. So I think a big part of that, and a big part of what comes out of Laudato Si, is that if we had greater humility and saw ourselves, right, as responsible for creation to God, then in both, right, and that we are responsible for each other, that those links would be a little bit easier in terms of between human ecology and ecological justice. Any other questions, thoughts, comments? Tom?
I noticed, Dr. Clark, that when you talked about subsidiarity, you grew a little more energetic. There was some...
Don't turn on the news, that's what I've learned.
Has it been abused? Has that principle been cited in ways that are unfaithful to the tradition? You were very animated about that.
You're trying to make me be political. From my former professor, for all of the students here who are kind of imagine what it's like to stand up here and get asked a question by one of your old professors. The problem is that it's a both and kind of thing. And we often hear subsidiarity invoked as it simply means smaller government, right? And so you will, if you look here, subsidiarity be invoked for as reason and justification for cutting social protection programs, cutting funding for social protection programs, cutting ecological regulation and things for the EPA, right? All of these things, throwing it back to local governments and the states, kind of without much attention to the type of issue we're dealing with, right? And so we see in the American political debate subsidiarity be used as the reason to cut social protection and cut ecological protection, and we're seeing that right now, which is why, you know, I made the mistake of looking at my Twitter feed in between our sessions and things coming out of the budget and the questions of the EPA budget in particular, along with programs for poor communities. Subsidiarity is what a handful of people in American public life are trying to hide behind as justification for cutting ecological regulations and things like the Paris Accords. Trying very hard to not name individual people. They're the problems, right? It's only the Catholics who are using it. The number three in command in the US government in particular. Yes.
Building upon Father's question, how do you see that relating when an international covenant, an international charter explicitly incorporates the principle of subsidiarity into its founding documents? I think of the European Convention of Human Rights, for example, where for one of the bases of the European Union, you know, that's where they deliberately inserted that into the, you know, the government structure of how they choose to elaborate human rights and development. So is it more so a problem of subsidiarity? It's a problem of the appropriate understanding of subsidiarity rather than the principle itself.
In establishing the European Covenant, they tried, right, to actually understand, right, that isn't, I mean, they were forming a union as they were incorporating subsidiarity, right, so they weren't kind of, I'm not saying that they've practiced it particularly well, I'm just not well-versed enough in all of the battles in Europe to kind of know, but I do think it's interesting that they got it from, basically from Catholic social teaching, and incorporated it in. And there you see this attention to the both and, right? To where they need to come together and collectively. I mean, why were they forming the union in the first place, the economic union in the first place, as well as differences of culture, identity, thing, you know, ways of making food. It's my understanding that actually some of the biggest battles in Europe come down to defining food and what can be labeled as what in terms of food from my friends in Europe. But it is this both and, right? That's something like, think of infrastructure. Or think of if we had seriously kind of support for places that are dealing with massive amounts of refugees, right? So not the United States or Europe, but Lebanon and Jordan and Kenya, and everybody bordering conflicts where there's just massive amounts of people, right? And countries that don't have an abundance of economic resources to begin with, right? Subsidiarity would say that yes, right, the people bordering a conflict are the people who are going to be, in many ways, right, the first responders, right? But that the rest of the international community has a responsibility to allocate significant resources and give them what they need in order to do that, right? That would be an application of subsidiarity, which isn't happening at the level in which it should happen. And so it isn't that kind of, okay, well, everybody can just equally deal with refugees. I mean, the simple location and boundaries of physical reality say that no, the countries bordering a conflict people are fleeing from are going to bear the brunt, right? But how do we give them the resources because they are unable to do that without help, right? That's the kind of unable, right? Not that they're unwilling necessarily, but that they're unable to do that. That subsidiarity would be one of the instruments where you would use in Catholic social thought to make an argument for the responsibility of the rest of the international community to allocate sufficient personnel and resources and things needed by the countries bordering and bearing the brunt of the global refugee crisis. Does that make sense or help?
Well, I think our time has come to an end, and I think that Dr. Clark's talk really emphasizes how important it is to have an integrated understanding of Catholic social teaching and human rights. And so we're grateful for that insight, and I really want to invite you again to join us for the launch and demonstration of our Convocate database next door right now with great food, lots of it, in the Center for Digital Scholarship in the library. We will lead the way there. But please join me in thanking Dr. Meghan Clark.
Thank you all for coming.